If we could come to order, please. Can I welcome everybody to this cabinet meeting? Thank you very much. Of course. Welcome. Welcome to this meeting. Cabinet, let's get straight into the agenda. Item one is members' code of conduct. Do any members of the cabinet wish to declare any interests? Angie?
Yes, I need to declare an interest in agenda item three on page 9, the All Age Disability Mental Health Services by virtue of my employment with Cheshire and Moreland Partnership.
Okay, Chris?
Thank you, Phil. It's actually the same, I think, by CWP as well.
Okay, so we'll note that. Any other members? No? Okay. Right, minutes. I've got two sets of minutes to agree. Is the minutes of the cabinet on the 23rd of July and also the cabinet on the 16th of July. Can we agree that I sign those for true record?
Yeah.
I agree. Thank you.
Required, and this is evidence of the latest report on decisions we make and how we operate as a Labour-led administration. This will be the first of what we hope will be many such development schemes on rural waters and will be a catalyst for a series of other developments in the area. There are many economic growth and social value benefits in relation to this particular development and investment. These 500 units will contribute to our local plan targets and lessen the need to release and agree about land. They will also contribute to and will help us achieve our rural plan pledge of building 3,500 homes by 2020. The council also received council tax and business rate income from the development upon completion, as well as it generating a future ongoing revenue stream for the council to help us in our funding responsibilities. The Legacy Foundation will provide £100,000 investment into the high-view zone, which is fabulous. The whole of Wirral Waters 1 development will also provide additional construction jobs, apprenticeships, and promote investor confidence in the area. This is a really good news story. There is an immense amount of work and due diligence that has taken place to get us to this point. And I am proud of the vital part that the council plays in this development. I'm asking Cabinet to agree to the four recommendations on pages 60 and 61 so that we can move to the next stage of this exciting and transformational development.
Thank you, Archie. Thank you very much. Anybody want to add to that? So Chris and then Paul. Chris first.
Thanks, Phil. Can I just say that the Belong scheme, you know, the specialist dimension here, village, is going to be so important. And as the scheme is in my ward anyway, I am absolutely delighted with this. I think it shows that, you know, we are going places, and hopefully this is going to be a real start for other developments for me.
Okay, thank you. Paul?
Thanks, Phil. Neil Holmes consistently sent their developer and supportive partners. They now have the funding from Aviva and have always had the backing for Rural Council and its residents. The time is now for people to start delivering on their promises they have made, developing the brownfield land that they own and play their part in providing high quality homes, local amenities, developing communities of the future and encouraging future generations to stay and invest here in Wirral, keeping Wirral pound in Wirral. This project is supported by partners and investors, will hopefully give the market confidence that is needed, proving that Wirral is a place to invest and build in the future of its residents. I hope Cabinet and Wirral Council will back this project, and we should look forward to working with Peel on what I hope is the first of many projects to be delivered by Peel on their journey to deliver 13,000 units as promised, and helping us to deliver our local plan and avoid building on our green belt.
Okay. Anybody else? Phil, yeah.
Thanks, Phil. I just want to say how happy I am with this project and how proud I am of our insisting on twice what we require for affordable rents. Yeah. Where the government is not putting forward the correct legislation, I'm happy to make the decisions that are immediately what it should be. That's it.
Yeah, Jeanette.
Thanks, Phil. This project is a perfect example of how our commercial strategy is really belonging to the land in this council. And the heartening thing for me is our social value policy is underpinned, and we'll underpin everything that we do as a council. So there's real ambition here for our young people, for, you know, local employ locally to procure, locally to provide jobs, and that's really great. That's part of the good news that's in this story.
Just a very quick one to say that I'm absolutely delighted after nearly 2 years of coming together on a very sound commercial basis to get to this position that we are at long last on the paper and signing up a deal which I believe is going to be living between Birkenhead and Morsey. It's got real scope to look at over the coming years. And I can only say that working together and working together commercially is the way forward and the only way forward to achieve what we want to do as a scheme. So I'm delighted that we're here today, the position ready to sign the deal off and move forward. Thank you.
Okay, Marley?
Just a quick one. It's just, I think this is a really good example of the fact that people have faith in the administration here on the ground, that they like what's happening on the ground, and that investors are quite prepared to come to the ground and invest in the ground. So I think it's a really good example that people from the outside are looking at us and like what we're doing. I think it's a good start to where we're going.
Okay, that's great. If I could just sort of say a few things in addition to other cabinet members, and I kind of agree with everything people said. I think this is a milestone today, the fact that we're agreeing this project. And you know, there's been a lot of debate in the press of in recent weeks about you know, us challenging people to get building. I think, you know, my focus throughout all of this is, you know, we need to work together. We need to work together in partnership to get building houses on brownfield sites. And Wirral Waters is the biggest brownfield site that we've got in the borough. And it's great that we've been able to reach this point now. We're able to agree the deal. So, you know, I think we need to focus on that bigger picture. How can we build effectively a new community in that part of Seacombe, in that part of Wirral? And I think this is a start, and Angie, you use the word catalyst, and I genuinely do believe it's the catalyst for a whole series of other developments. Hopefully, you know, we've got the urban splash housing development. You mentioned the Long Dementia Care Centre, we've got the Maritime Knowledge Hub, you know, we've got the Skills Factory, lots of other things. And I think this will only help to pave the way for those other developments and start to see what will basically be a completely new kind of township, if you like, within that part of an area that for decades has been abandoned and not used. So I'm sure we all wish it well, and I'm sure we all will look forward to the apartments appearing in the ground. I think the I think, Angie, as you said, the other big benefit of this is in the context of the discussions we're having around our local plan. Obviously, this helps us achieve our housing target, and you know, that's absolutely critical. And we've said, you know, thankfully the housing, the top line housing targets come down in the latest LMS figures, but we've said that you know, we will absolutely bend it backwards to make sure that we will use every scrap of brownfield plan to build houses on. It's a brownfield policy first, and this will absolutely relieve pressure on our kind of precious green belt, which is what we've said from day one. And I think for me, the kind of social value elements, the affordable housing, the fact that as part of the procurement process, we're going to make sure that the building elements with local labour, as you said, Jeanette, and apprenticeships, you know, hire local and buy local, they're key elements. And this shows we're putting a labour stamp on this policy. So, and it also enables us to deliver George our pledge, in one of our key pledges in our world plan. So I think from all of those perspectives, it is a landmark decision. And I think we'll be, as you said, quite rightly, the catalyst for everything else. Final thing I want to say is a big thank you, really, to our officers who have worked tirelessly. I know this has been a long and exhaustive negotiation, as these things always are. But I think throughout the whole of the process, our officers have always made sure that the deal will give good value for rural council taxpayers, and that's been the thing that has driven our side in the negotiations. So thank you, Eric, to everybody in the team for being part of that as well. Others for getting us to the position we're in. I be able to sign it off?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so recommendations for the period of pages 62 to 63. Angie's movement. Can we read those recommendations? Yes, and can we deal with, yeah, thanks for that, for reminding me. Can we do, well, we need to go to attention, don't we?
No, just pass the resolution.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but unless you're going to exclude pass and vote.
Just the papers, unless you're going to talk to us.
No.
Then if you pass it, that just puts the papers into it.
Okay, so what do I need to
vote in respect of those papers?
So in respect of the exempt papers?
Yes.
The item number?
Yes.
What, just to approve that?
Yes, to approve that they'll be considered an exempt.
Oh, we're going to consider them an exempt. Yeah, okay, so we'll come to that. We'll come to that at the end. Okay, fine. So we agree that recommendation on item 6. Yes? Okay?
Yeah.
Great. Right, fantastic. Thank you very much. And thanks, Angie, for all your hard work as well. Okay, so let's go back to our agenda. So the next item is item 4. Continuing healthcare scrutiny review, and we've got in front of us the adult care and health overview scrutiny committee minute that looked at the scrutiny review on continuing healthcare, and this is now coming before the cabinet to discuss. And I'm going to ask Chris just to introduce this, please, Chris.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I'd like to say thank you really to the members of the scrutiny committee who have done such a very good job on this. Continuing healthcare funding has obviously made a great contribution in some ways. But I think the fact that I've took this report on page 15 of the report, Sue Wells, Chair of the CCG, has agreed that the CCG will bring a plan to the Joint Commissioning Board. And I'd just like to say I welcome that, and hopefully we can work with the CCG and with scrutiny around that.
Okay. Fine. So anybody else want to add anything to that? So we're being asked to endorse the recommendation of the scrutiny. Sorry, we're being asked to endorse the recommendation of the scrutiny committee and the recommendations from the review panel. And I think we just add our thanks to those members who took part in that review for an extremely useful piece of work. Can we agree that recommendation? Thank you very much. Okay, thank you. Item 5 is Audit and Risk Management Committee annual report for 2017-2018. This is one of the regular sort of statutory reports that comes to cabinet. Effectively, we're just being asked to approve the annual report. I'm not really going to say anything more than that. I think it's self-explanatory. So, can I move that we approve that report? Is that agreed?
Yes, agreed.
Yes. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, so to cabinet members' report, we've dealt with Murray Waters 1, so let's go on to item 7, which is consideration of proposal to implement selective licensing following consultation. George, can you introduce this, please?
Certainly can, thanks, Rob. I want to start by saying, first of all, I think this is probably one of the most popular amongst councillors in particular, and members of the public, reports to come out. I've been inundated for the last 18 months, 2 years, about when's it going to be our turn to get the scheme. My personal view is that what we're doing is absolutely perfect. It's four areas at this moment in time, with a proposal to bring in other four areas, which will benefit those areas. A lot of things have happened over the last 10 years. In the last 10 years, the market has changed completely. So when we had 18-19% of world stock, which was in the social sector, now went into the private rented sector. And therefore, the social sector has now come down to around about 10-11%. We need to understand that from where we start from. And people moved for one reason or another, bedroom tax and different things that have come in over the past 2 months. And I think we are on that specific moment in time. I want to start by saying the scheme itself has been absolutely well received by everybody. And I think you'll see that in the local papers, the Common and the Globe in particular, there was 3 or 4 good articles where landlords have been taken to court because they have not completed satisfactorily to what Will's recommendations are. And there have been some absolutely appalling sites that I've seen. The fines that have come through the courts have been justifiable. They have reached, in some instances, up to £30,000-£40,000 against the landlord. And that, in today's living, is absolutely appalling when you think about it. But I'm grateful to say that 98% of the landlords have bought into this scheme, and without any problem, they've bought into it. So therefore, they've become what you call the easy ones, which basically say, we give you a right to join the scheme at this price as an early day buyer. If you don't, it will cost you an extra couple of £100 to join in. Most people have joined on the basis that they've joined it because they want to join it and have their properties inspected, brought to complete standard. And I'd say that 98% of the people in Will at this moment in time see this scheme as the way forward. It, unfortunately, I firmly believe the scheme we've got at this present moment in time is the right one. Liverpool went for a blanket cover, which covers the whole of Liverpool. And what it does is it creates divisions between different parts of Liverpool in particular. Whereas here, we know what we're looking at. Our officers are doing an excellent first-class job. They've paid for this scheme basically themselves out of the resulting monies that come in. And it's at this point that we're now ready to move forward with the latest 4 parts. And I want to emphasise categorically that Willowbrook Council have no say in where those 4 areas are. They come from statistics which are held in London. They come up and basically say to us they're based on a lot of criteria. These are the areas we believe that you should look at in the first instance. So the first instance, the ones they've come back with on this time, following on from the successful last 2.5 years, 3 years, is Hamilton Square area, Seacombe St Paul's area, Birkenhead West and Birkenhead Central. So based on the maps are there for everyone to see where they are, and I've had, I think, just like Cabinet before we came here, I must have met, I think, about 14 lots of landlords through the talk, that must have talked about it. There were some people who were totally opposed to it, but on the same thing, I think when I explained to them, and officers explained to them what it was all about, they have bought into the scheme up front. So I think there's 1 or 2 people said, I'd never join it, anybody else. And I know 1 or 2 of them people have already felt that they're off the council because they haven't used their skills, I suppose, as the word before, and they've come up with properties which are absolutely appalling. So based on the feedback and the consultation on the technical and local delegates, use the business case rationale, members are asked to approve the extension of Willow Selective Licensing Scheme for all tenanted properties within these additional 4 designated areas under Section 80 of the Housing Act 2004. I know what we will receive, but I ask Councillor Air to support the recommendations and These will come into effect if it goes to cabinet this morning on the 1st of November 2018. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, George. Any cabinet members wish to comment? Angie and then Jeanette.
Yeah, I just wanted to say I think this is a fabulous scheme, George, and it kind of really cracks down on those few rogue landlords that make people's lives in misery. And I know when we've kind of spoken, you know, we've consulted on this, and we were speaking to people on the doorsteps, and we were campaigning, you know, this was viewed really, really positively by people, and got a really strong endorsement. So I'm really happy to support these recommendations today.
Thanks, Angie. Jeanette?
Thanks, Bill. I mean, you know, decent housing, decent quality housing is fundamental to people's physical and mental well-being. And we've got a duty here today, the council, to ensure that we make landlords provide just that. I think going back as far as the abolition of fair rent, it's been really, we've seen a deterioration in some sectors, private sectors. Our residents deserve better than some of these rogue landlords who you know, are taking advantage of the fact that we're only forced, decimating people's incomes, their housing benefits being reduced, and some of them are often a bit more than slums, and quite frankly, it's not good enough. Our residents deserve better. This is a fantastic scheme to well done everyone involved.
Okay, Paul.
Thanks, Phil. This has been a great initiative, and I've probably been one of the ones that wanted it right across the board. I completely accept that, you know, just blanket is not going to be impossible. This has been definitely a great project, and I'm glad that the initiative has been extended. Because it is driving up housing standards for our residents, and the prosecutions are evidence of this local administration takes the housing standards of our residents seriously. We want high quality housing for residents where they can live healthy, happy lives with responsible landlords, providing a service to their clients and not providing, as a colleague of mine was saying, tomorrow's slums today, and only interested in the profits that they can make on this reasonable business. So I do support this judgment.
Okay, thanks, Paul. Bernie and then Matthew.
Yeah, George, you know the scheme as we were part of the first scheme that set up down here in Egremont, and it made a real difference. And you could see right from the very beginning that landlords were replacing windows and doing their properties up right from the very beginning, so it did make a difference. And we had a massive, massive problem with, I won't name the home, but we had antisocial behaviour where the residents had been absolutely blighted by one home. And thanks to the scheme, we got that sorted out and we tackled that landlord, and that landlord's house was shut down. I think it was shut down for 6 months, and he has to operate under completely different rules, regulations now. So it's made a real difference to the people of Egremont, and it's amazing the difference it will make to other communities. So I welcome this, and I think it's a real, real, really amazing initiative. And as you say, it's once again, it's Labour values pushing this forward, making sure that our residents have decent houses and decent homes.
Okay, Matthew.
Thank you, Phil. I think Ben just said it's Labour values. I feel really proud to support it. Completely support the one in George. And I think it shows you there's ever a question sort of who stands up for who on these issues and on the big issues. You know, it's a chance to having a good, safe, nice home to live in is fundamental to your happiness and to your health. And I think this is a real clear demonstration of where Labour have gone. Also, you know, people have been calling for this for some time, and you've worked on this, George, for ages. I remember an old colleague, Councillor Matthew Daniel, was one of the people really pushing for this as well. Yeah, and I just think, I feel like it's a real coming together of a lot of people's effort and work over many years. We should be enormously proud of this, and I hope it just needs to still improving standards of housing and homes. So thank you, George.
Okay, thank you. Phil?
Thanks, Phil. It's an all-out from the council. You get to vote for a policy which you can really agree.
Yeah.
And I'm really grateful that I'm having the opportunity to do that, and it's thanks to you, George, and all your hard work. It puts road landlords on notice again in the area, and it makes it clear that slums are horrible and this council will not tolerate it.
Yeah.
And so,
I was going to say something, but you've all started. I just want to add my thanks really to George, as a portfolio holder, for leading on sponsoring. I just want to remind everybody that the selective licensing policy was a Labour initiative about three years ago. We introduced it as a budget policy, and we invested, I think, in that year about £350,000 in getting this off the ground. And I think you just need to read the reports that we've got today about the benefits that this is having here, pages 81 and 82. This is the benefits of the distinct selective licensing scheme, not just in terms of improving the physical standards of properties, but also helping the tenants who live in these properties in terms of their health and their well-being, which is as important as the physical. Well, the two are interrelated, okay. So yeah. I think this is a tried and tested scheme. George, as you quite rightly say, you know, we don't have a kind of any kind of discretion over where we target areas. It's based on the data of deprivation and other indices. So we've applied that rigorously. But it's so pleasing, really, that we're going to be able to extend the benefits of this scheme to these four additional areas. So, you know, that will mean more standards will improve, and more residents and tenants of these properties will benefit, and their quality of life will improve, which is what we're all about. So, yeah, I think this is a very welcome report. Just ask you to look at the recommendations now on page 74, which George has moved. Can we agree those recommendations? Okay, we wish the extension, the new scheme as well, coming into place in November. So that's great, thanks very much. Okay, so that's the last main item before we go into exemption. Yes. But before we go into exemption, while we're still in the public part of the meeting, I just want to say this is Matthew Patrick's final cabinet meeting. So Matthew, as I'm sure everybody knows, is going to new pastures. He's got a new exciting job down in London. So I just wanted to say on behalf of the cabinet, we wish him well in his new post. I personally just want to put on record my thanks, Matthew, to the fantastic job you've done as a cabinet member. First for the community engagement portfolio, where you do lots of great work around things like the constituency committees and rural view, which I'm still thinking is a great complication. And obviously, latterly, for the last few months, leading the environment portfolio and the great work you've done there. So I think it is important we place on record our sincere thanks to you for your service to the cabinet, but not to the cabinet, but to the council as a whole and to your constituency and to your board. And as I said at the start of my comments, we really wish you all the very best for the future, and I hope you have a very successful career in your new job. So I think I'd just like to put on record our appreciation. So thanks very much, Eddie.
I can just say very quickly, Phil, thank you very much. Liz, Chris, if you're going to get embarrassed now. try not to. It's been not just the cabinet, the council, it's been the privilege of my life to represent Oxenwood Church, Labour Church, and work with those residents. And in the last 2.5 years, to serve on your cabinet and to do things like not just over before about the licensing scheme, but so many other policies that have come through here, I will take so many lessons through the rest of my life working with fantastic councillors and fantastic officers and fantastic residents, and I'm enormously grateful to have the opportunity to serve my borough, and I want to thank you for that and wish all of you the very, very best, and I know we're all in good hands.
Yeah, thanks
for
Okay, so that concludes the public section of the agenda. Thanks everybody for their comments and their contributions. So I'm now going to move on item 8, The exempt resolution to exclude the press and public, is that seconded?
Seconded.
So that, can I ask the press and public please to leave the room? Thank you for your attendance.